Good morning all. We were discussing in the preceding slides the somoclonal variations. We have defined what are the somoclonal variations, how to name them, and what causes the somoclonal variations compared to the gametoclonal variations, which are nothing but the actual or natural variations produced. Later we have looked into the selection process wherein you can notify or notice the somoclonal variations during the culture, which is nothing but with in vitro selection, or in the second aspect, when you hardened the plant and transferred them into the field, later when the plant is growing, you can isolate the somoclonal variations. So this method is nothing but without in vitro selection. Now while comparing the pros and cons, we have to make sure that without in vitro selection, as it is nature's play, it may take n number of years, even some cases several decades might be required, especially in the perennials, wherein the very expression in terms of the fruit or seed or whatever desired character may take several years to get expressed. So better you have the with in vitro selection protocol, where the stress factor, for example aluminum or cadmium or any heavy element, or if you are looking for a disease resistance character, then you can isolate the disease causing agent, maybe in the form of a chemical, and inoculate them in a media, and whatever the leftover plants, most of the times if you have cultured 100x plants, 90 or 95 or well above that plants, explants may die, but whatever the fractions left over, they could be certainly resistive to the very much stress factor which you have inoculated along with the explant, incorporated in the media along with the explant. Later the factors which may actually affect the somoclonal variations, it could be a genotype, as I said, one plant could be different than the other because of its DNA content. So genotype is the major factor for the somoclonal variations. Then the duration of culture, as the culture gets older and older, then yes, you can easily obtain the somoclonal variation, but simultaneously what happens, you are compromising with the regeneration capacity. So because of this, we have to, you know, literally balance the somoclonal variations along with the realization of a plant from the explant. Now another factor again which could be incorporated in the duration of culture is that the age of the explant. Now when you have used the juvenile or young explants, then as the plant cells, they are all uniform because of their cytoplasmic content, you may not realize the somoclonal variations. But when the explant, whatever you have chosen in the form of a leaf, a node, internode, root, stem or whatever, if it is not the juvenile one or very old, then the cells would be almost forgotten the meristematic activity. They might be very large with the larger vacuoles. Then later these large or mature cells, they have to be de-differentiated and form the meristematic cells, and from that meristematic cells you may have to regenerate the plants. So even the age of the explant, they do exert their own impact in obtaining the somoclonal variations. Older the explant, yes, more are the chances of obtaining the somoclonal variations. Younger the explant, there are less chances of obtaining the somoclonal variations. But the negative shade is, younger the culture, less number of somoclonal variations. More, if the explant is aged, then more number of somoclonal variations, but regeneration capacity goes down. Now the next factor, it could be the growth regulator. Most of us may not address the issue of growth regulator. What we think auxins, cytokinins, gibberellins, abscisic acid and ethylene as the positive factors, but remember, whatever the auxins you use in the form of NAA, 240, IAA, IBA or whatever auxins, simultaneously you might use BA, BAP, TDZ, zeatin, adenine, the derivatives of adenine, they are nothing but the cytokinins, or abscisic acid, ethylene, which is seldom in use, or gibberellic acid. Over 70 different types of gibberellic acid are there. Though they stimulate the growth, it's all because of their stress factors. The same stress factor may result in the artifacts or nothing but the somoclonal variations. Imagine, you might not believe me, but if they are actually the boosting factors, probably you may never witness somoclonal variations in vitro. So growth regulators do exert the somaclonal variations because of their very chemical nature. Now, explant, in few of the species, for example, carrot, the somaclonal variations could be easily produced when you start with the carrot root. But the in the same plant, if you start with the leaf as an explant or the inflorescence as an explant or node as an explant, probably the chances of obtaining somaclonal variations might not be superior compared to the root. So different explants, different variations, different results. Now the selection agent and a technique, as already quoted, if you are looking for the aluminum toxicity but you have failed to incorporate the very element into the media, probably all your experiment goes in vain without any successful result or a somaclonal variation. So we have to smartly choose or wisely choose the selective agent and a technique. If it is causing in one or the other way the resistivity, then only it gets reflected in the plant whatever you are going to produce. So smartly or wisely we need to use the or choose the selective agent as well as the technique. Now technique here refers to, it could be the selection of a media, it could be the solid or suspension culture, or even in a different container. Some of the, you might not believe, some of the variations could be easily resulted when you have chosen very large container because of the very gaseous mixture. The oxygen will be different, the carbon dioxide will be different, nitrogen could be different. These may also indirectly affect the genotype, and gradually the DNA altered may result in the somaclonal variation. So even such small things do neglect, they do exert on their own the variations produced. Then the regeneration capacity, as I said, in different factors, for example the oldness of the culture or the very age of the explant, though in most of the cases variations are produced genotypically, but in most of the times, over 90% of the cases, whatever in vitro you have realized that okay, this cells could be with the variation, you may not convert, you are unable to convert those explants or those callus into the new plant. So this becomes the major bottleneck. Now when you look into the somaclonal variations, it has got, yes, very of the usefulness, but simultaneously we should not neglect the limitations of it. The first limitation itself is not useful. Yes, you have heard it right. Most of the somaclonal variations are undesired. Just consider the example of a basmati rice. Now, when you have used the basmati rice and you want to obtain huge yield in terms of the phenotypic change, it could be your dream as a somaclonal variation. What if you have obtained 99 plants, but all of them are not even producing the same yield as that of a mother plant? This becomes a limitation. Simultaneously, you have to throw them into the bin, and whatever you have done till now, it gets wasted. So, as I said, it's a chance factor, and most of the cases, whatever the variations you have generated, it is not useful. The second one, the very basis of somaclonal variations, it is a chance factor, and nothing is in your hand. Though we say technically in vitro selections you can do wonders, but in reality it is very seldom that most of the variations they are useful. Then the third and foremost important is, most of the variations they are not heritable as well as they are not very stable. What does it mean? The variations may last one generation or two generations, but it will not last for n number of other generations, as it is not inherited from one generation to the next generation, as the somaclonal variations might have resulted because of the mitotic cells. The other limitation is, somaclonal variations can pose a serious problem in many micropropagation protocol, wherein you want to have the uniform clones. Whatever the offsprings you are generating, if they are uniform, then only the micropropagation becomes successful. But in the case of the somaclonal variations, most of them, they are not useful or they are inferior to the mother plant, definitely if you are an entrepreneur, you don't get the consumer to buy your products. So this becomes the major limitations. Now these are few of the examples. This is the case of the colocasia, wherein you can notice easily the different variations produced. This is the normal plant, compared to that you have different variations produced. Similarly, from the wide ansorium, you can do create the chimera. Chimera is nothing but in a single leaf you can notice two different portions, one with the albinism and the other which looks normal. When the cells get separated, segregation happens, gradually you tend to get the variations which gets reflected in its phenotype. Similarly, other commercial aspects, commercial plants, maybe the chrysanthemum or other plants, marigold, or even in the fruit plants, the strawberries, they have tried to create the somacolor variations. Most of the times you may get the desired product, but in other cases, yes, though there is a variations, it might not be reflected in a fruitful manner. Yeah, this is another beautiful example, the chrysanthemum variety, wherein the somacolon variations really have produced the beautiful petal variations. And this is also another example wherein the colocasia was the mother plant, but you just notice the different variations, but which cannot be sold in a market. Yes, these are the variations, but it don't have any commercial value. This actually underlines the very nature of the somacolon variation, which is a chance factor. Hope you have understood with respect to the somacolon variations. Thank you.